Good evening. Before I begin the meeting, as you all know, I was unable to attend opening day of school and speak to the faculty and staff. So I would like to take a moment to welcome you all back and know that this school board appreciates your efforts that are expended in creating an outstanding educational climate and situation for our students. I wish I could have said that to everyone, and I hope you'll take that personal message back to your faculty and staff as we begin this new year. Thank you. With that, this is the September 2005 business meeting of the Cape Elizabeth School Board. If we would all rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Although we do not have a large audience tonight, since this is the first meeting of the year, I'd like to go over some of the ground rules for school board business meeting in terms of public comment. There are a number of opportunities at the beginning and the end of the meeting for the public to comment. This is not an opportunity for debate. It is an opportunity for us to hear the public's thoughts on a specific title. The board may ask follow-up questions, but we will not engage in a discussion of whatever the item is at this point in time. And as in terms of regularly scheduled agenda items, any member of the public is welcome to speak under the same rules that we will not necessarily engage in a conversation. And the final item is that we will not at any time engage in a conversation relative to identifiable personnel and students. And let's begin with item number one. Well, item number two, adjustments to the agenda. I know we have a few. One of them is we will be adding a section called appointments to new business in anticipation of adoption of new policy regarding school board appointments. Are there other items? Elaine?
Yes, I was wondering if I could make a report on the part of the planning committee. We left that
out. I'm sorry, if we left that out, I apologize, and that does belong on the new list of items to be reported, so please do that. Okay. We'll add that, Ellen. Any other items?
I think just the other thing is that the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation report would be under the appointed committees.
Certainly.
Section?
Yes.
There's also two athletic committees listed there. I believe there should be one.
I think we can fix those at a later date and simply say no report as they come up tonight. And we can adjust them on the permanent agenda.
Okay.
Are there any other adjustments?
There was a request, Alan, to have the request for trips moved up in the agenda so they wouldn't have to wait.
Yes, that's right. I'm sorry. We did have that request. We have three field trips. Which have been proposed, not field trips, but out-of-state trips and overseas trips, I believe. And it was asked if they could be early on the agenda because some people will be here tonight to talk briefly about those.
Well, certainly, and perhaps we ought to do that as a regular item instead of adjusting the agenda every time a trip comes up and find a way to insert those type of items to an earlier point on the agenda. Any others? Seeing none, we'll move on to approval of school board minutes. We have minutes from the regular school board meeting on June 14th. We have a special meeting which was held on July 14th and another special meeting on June 24th. Are there any corrections or comments on those minutes? Seeing none, all in favor of approving the minutes? they're approved. Communications.
The first one you have before you is Volunteer Services Annual Report, submitted by Gail Schmader, who is the director. What she has presented to you, I believe, is an annual report that she gives to you, which basically talks about the different programs that she has offered, using community resources, student volunteers, other programs that are within the system. What I would say about it, I certainly am not going to take the time to go through it, and I don't see Gail out here, am I correct? What I would say about it is this, is as a new superintendent here, I would tell you that you have an amazing volunteer program. There's no question about it. Some of the programs that she has got in here, having worked in districts that had volunteer programs also, I have not seen one as comprehensive as this one is. And so I would say to you that the money that is spent for Gail's position is money very well spent. And I had the opportunity to go to the middle school the other night when they had their curriculum night, and I was just amazed at the number of volunteers that were there who work on a regular basis to at that school. And I know the same thing happens at Pond Cove and to a perhaps lesser extent, but in a different way, at the high school. I don't know if you have any questions about Gail's report. If you do, I'd be happy to answer them at this time.
Okay.
I also have a couple of memos from the Special Service Director regarding a need for an additional head tech. Basically, what she has provided for you is information about the fact that we have had an influx of new special ed students appearing here this year. What I have provided for you is a letter that Claire sent to me, taking out names because obviously I could not leave those in there, but talking about the fact that we have increased by 16, I believe, at this point. And at this point, we have two students who present with mental retardation, 5 learning disability, 3 autism, 3 with language impairment, 1 with orthopedic impairment, 1 with other health impairment. Recognizing the fact that this could lead to a need for an additional ed tech. And with your permission, Mr. Chair, I would ask Claire if she would like to speak to this at this point in time.
Claire?
As you know, we keep having to re-examine the number of students we have in our programs and the number of staff members we have. And when school ended in June, we felt very comfortable that we were all set and that what we had predicted at budget time would cover the needs that we had in December. Unfortunately, we had, I think now we're up to 17 students that have moved in since I've written the memo, with an IEP, and legally we need to implement their programs as soon as they come, which we are doing. What I have been doing is working very closely with all the special ed teachers and monitoring their schedules, because I didn't want to go out and say that we were going to hire somebody ASAP until all the related service providers had scheduled the students into their schedules. But it's very clear at this point that we definitely need some additional staff. Any questions?
It would be helpful to know what we would forecast that additional ed tech salary to be. I understand we can't say the additional ed tech salary, what it might be. At least we have a range.
Okay. I think you emailed me, and I emailed you. If you look, do you have a copy of their contracted agreement, the contractual agreement? No. Okay. It's listed in there because they have a contract that has been settled until 2007, and it's listed right in there. So I can definitely photocopy that for you. When we interview people, we really aim to hire the best candidate with the best qualifications because we feel it's important. But
a range, we don't even need to get specific, but a range would help give us an idea as to how this is going to impact our budget.
Okay. I think when you emailed me, I responded, it was like, I think it's, if they're on a level, an EdTech 2, if they're if they have 0 to 5 years experience, it's $12.80 an hour, and I think if they have 15 years experience, which we haven't been that lucky, it's like $15 an hour.
Yeah, unfortunately, I'm not educated enough in how many hours somebody would work.
35 hours a week.
Okay.
Sorry.
That's okay. And how many hours there are in a year. And so I'm trying to get to an annual figure for our annual budget.
Between 20 and 25,000.
Great. Thank you, Pauline.
And some benefits that they choose.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions?
I just want to clarify with you, Claire, there are no federal funds available for these 17 new students in this year's budget.
The federal funds that we get are based on the child count that we had at December 1st, 2004. And then, yeah, so 2005,
yeah.
I have to stop and think. They will be counted December 1st, 05.
In terms of our overall student population, Claire, are these 17 students a net increase to the total school population?
Yes, because we have had less students that have exited than have enrolled.
Now, I'm not talking about special ed. I'm talking about the total population of the school. Is this an increase?
I would say yes.
We have an increase this year from estimated numbers to where we are now, 36 students. Mm-hmm. Amongst those students are 17 who have special ed needs.
All right. In that case, I think it behooves us to bring to the council's attention the fact that we have a real increase in student population versus an estimated increase in student population, which is supposed to be accommodated for an additional funds. It's certainly worth exploring if that was, in fact, the intent of the council. Thank you, Claire. Anyone else?
The last communication that I have is also from Claire, and this deals with ESL population, English as a second language. As she has noted in this, our English as a second language population has doubled with 6 new students, and I believe, if I'm not mistaken, we have at least one more new student added today from the high school, 2 more new students added from the high school. The general process when you have an ESL student come into the system is that the students are tested using the WIDA OWIDA testing to see what level of need they have. My understanding is that we do have some who are pretty proficient in English as a language and so therefore may not need a lot of services. We do have probably a couple of 3 who will need. And so we are in the process right now of taking a look at their needs and determining from there. My understanding in talking with Claire today, at this point in time, we're not looking at any added staffing, but this is only an informational thing for you so you know that that population has increased at this point in time.
I have a question. Are there any federal requirements for programming that needs to be offered to ESL students?
We have requirements there. There is a state agency on English as second language, and so there are requirements by them. And the first step in the requirement is to do an assessment to see what the needs are of that student. And then we have to report to the state what programs we're offering. There is also money available based on your total ESL population. And so those are pieces we will be working out with the state. Barney Berube is the person at the state level who oversees that program. And so there are both requirements and financial assistance available. And those are the only communications that I have at this point. Unless you want to add to that, as you just said a few minutes ago, if you would like to add these requests for field trips to the communications piece.
Yes, why don't we insert them now before we do comments from the public.
Okay. The first one that I have is from David Perry, who's a French teacher at Cape Elizabeth High School. Are you speaking to that?
No, I'm actually not, but I'm gonna ask if it's possible. David thought that
it was going to be late.
Didn't realize that the meeting's going to be at 7 and had shifted to 7:05. So I've got Mark and Douglas, I've got more Soma here, where David should be here,
Okay, so I'll go to number two, and I will go to the trip to Costa Rica. Just one quick check on this request. If you read the first sentence, it talks about this is a Spanish trip, and it's going to with a school in France. So that I think that perhaps was a problem with the template that we were using. Mark, would you like to speak to that, please?
We'll be happy to go to France as well.
We were looking to see if there was a Costa Rican community in France. I wasn't sure.
Sure. You're correct about the template. I did a trip about, I think it was 3 years ago now. It was with the Council on Foreign Exchange, which was endorsed by the Principals Association and so forth and so on. But they aren't doing a lot of high school exchanges anymore. But while I was down there and did that trip to Costa Rica, the people that they use down there are the people that I'm using right now. It's called the Intercambio Cultural Internacional, I think is the name of it. And they were great. They had everything lined up. They also do, this group does a exchange with Humboldt University, I believe in Ohio, where they bring teachers down and so forth. So the plan is to use this in-country group to plan the whole thing. They've been doing it for years. It's a family-run organization. And to go, to have the Costa Rican students come here in January, I believe it's January 22nd, to February 13th, I think that's the dates. I don't have the paper in front of me right now because I left my house in a hurry thinking that the school board meeting started at 7. There we go. January 13th to February 3rd, okay. So they were planning on coming here because in Costa Rica, the time they have in between school years is January, and this is the only time they can come. Scarborough does a similar thing. They have Costa Rican kids come in January. And they haven't had any problems with that. It falls, I believe, in their midterm times as well, but there's always something to do while kids are studying for midterms. And then our proposed trip would be in April to take the first week before April vacation, then the week during April vacation, and then, like I did last time, 3 days on the other side of April vacation to come back on either Tuesday or Wednesday. So the kids would be staying for 2 weeks. They'd be staying with a family. We have a school that I've gotten email communications from Costa Rica. They have a school, Colegio Green Valley, I think is the name of it. And I asked them, you know, why is it Green Valley and not Valle Verde or something like that? But it's a private school there. And they have a very tight screening process. They got us a great school the last time. I got to know the organization down there, this family. They have 13 kids right now that want to come here. So that means we'd go with 13 kids down there. And the kids would stay with the families. I would stay with probably the teacher and another family. We'd have a selection process. And this group, the Intercambio Cultural, I talked to them also about insurance, and they said that they could and had a package available, which I can get a copy of their insurance forms and all this sort of thing to you. So I'm presenting this to you, I think for a month ahead of time so you can think about it, and then if we could proceed with it, then I can make it available to the kids if it meets with your approval. Any questions?
I do. This really pertains to all three of the trips that are being presented tonight. First let me say that I think the trips sound great, and mm-hmm. I think it's wonderful that we have staff that are, you know, wanting to make these kinds of things happen for our students. I feel I should probably understand this by now, but I'm afraid I don't. I'm not really clear on these trips. You know, what we're really, I understand that we're voting on, we would rather be approving the, you know, the time off, but, you know, looking at your sentence here that this trip is not a mandatory piece of the curriculum of any course, and then looking back at our policy for excursions and trips, I'm just trying to understand what the responsibility and or the liability of the school district, you know, really is. And I guess in the past we've pretty much, is this correct, voted on the time off.
That's correct.
But I'm just raising this because I think it's a little bit fuzzy, because I think it appears as though, you know, because we're approving it, that we're, that it really is related to the curriculum, and I just need to get some, you know, clarity around what the responsibility of the district is for trips like these.
And that's a question I don't think that the people presenting tonight can actually answer. I think that
I just need to understand what we'd be voting on.
Yeah, exactly. We might have to be answering that question, which is a really good question. Because I also have a question that pertains to all three trips that had never occurred to me before. Mark, in your case, how many actual school days will the students be missing?
It'd be seven.
Seven.
Mm-hmm. Maybe eight.
Yeah. Is there a plan in place to make up the work with the other classes that they're taking?
Always.
Always.
I mean, at least for my part, I always make sure that the kids have everything lined up. When I was in Costa Rica, I made time during the school day when I was there. I took them out of the Costa Rican classes because they were supposed to spend time. And I said, okay, you guys have a two-hour block and do your work here. So we had kids in calculus, advanced calculus. They were doing their work during that period of the daytime. So I made a time specifically for them to get their work done so that they could then enjoy being with the families and so forth afterwards during their school day. But they did spend some time there. I don't know what David had planned, but I'm sure he'll let you know, or what he's done in the past.
What I would like to suggest is when the final package comes into us, that plan be included with the package of information.
Okay.
Alan or Pauline, can either of you answer Ann's question?
I can at this point. What I can say to you is that I'm looking at the insurance that is provided by the travel company.
Mm-hmm.
But I think what Ann is asking is for the system itself, what kind of liability do we take on at that point in time? And I would suggest, unless Pauline can answer, that's a research piece that we would need to do and bring back to you, unless it is something that's been answered before because of trips. And Pauline, I don't know if there is an answer to that or not.
No, the only thing I can say is that they're going under the auspices of the Cape Elizabeth School Department. Even though it's separate from the curriculum, they're still Cape Elizabeth High School students, staff members, and staff members have to be covered under our insurance policy.
That's what I kind of assumed.
But we can research that a little further.
Yes, would you please, Pauline, because I think we've danced around this question before without really getting a good understanding of the liability issues. And I do know that if we're going under the auspices of the school district, that we have liability regardless of what other insurance might or might not be available.
We will do research on that and bring that back to you.
Pending the reply to that, is there anyone else who has questions or concerns about this particular trip? Go ahead, Elaine.
I just want to say, Mark, I remember seeing the presentation 3 years ago when you came back. You shared with the board at the time what the students had done with you down in Costa Rica. And I have two daughters, one who unfortunately waited and just graduated right before you could do it again, but I have another one who's very actually awaiting our vote.
No pressure.
Yeah.
And I don't want to give the impression that I don't think the trips, you know, should happen or that you shouldn't move forward on them. I just want us to have the answers and really understand. I mean, if there were some kind of accident or, you know, that kind of thing.
If I was a school board member, I would think exactly the same. And I'm also going to be investigating the insurance as well from my standpoint, because I'm not going through counsel on foreign exchanges with this Intercambio Cultural, but they have a great track record in Costa Rica, which is why counsel picked them to be their in-country coordinators. So,
if I could add, I think for the sake of the study that we're going to do on our liability, if each of you who are taking these trips could get the insurance information also from the company, then we can provide that also for information to our carriers to
Absolutely.
See what the comparisons are.
I've already requested it by email. I'm just waiting for them to send it to me.
Thank you, Mark.
Yeah, I think that any comments we've made to Mark apply to not only the other two trips under consideration right now, but to all future trips. The only, if there's no, nothing else to be added, I certainly hope that, Mark, we will continue to hear back after the trip is over on the experience, and that will be shared throughout the school. And I would hope that's the case for all the other trips as well. I know we've had some really exciting reports on these trips in the past, and I want to make sure that we continue doing that. If there are no other questions or concerns, can we give Mark a consensus on this, which we'll formally vote on the new business? And I don't see any objections, so Mark, please proceed with your trip planning.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
I see that David has arrived, but I will, since Morton was here before him, I'll have Morton Soule come up to talk about his trip as well.
Thank you, Mr. Hawkins. How many of you know what SPQR means? What it stands for? The four letters? It's ubiquitous. That's a Latin derivative. I better pronounce it correctly. Throughout Rome. Well, I'm not going to tell you. I want you to find out for yourselves. This trip will be very, actually, the students will report to you when they get back. The trip, of course, is very educational. Students at Cape Elizabeth High School study history, covering the periods from 753 BC to 14 AD. They read authors who were in and about Rome, Caesar, Cicero, Catullus, and the Maximus Magister of them all, Virgil. The dates that I have in mind, the students will not miss any days of school. It's a quick trip, leaving Saturday morning or Friday night for Boston, February 18th through the next Sunday, the 26th. It'll cover cities like Venice, Florence, St. Francis of Assisi, of course, was made that particular town legendary, Rome, and of course Pompeii. I've been to all of these cities. It was, of course, very educational, but also it's more than that. They will walk the very place where Caesar walked toward the Roman Forum. They'll find out that, in fact, with all due respect to Shakespeare, Caesar was not knocked down in the Roman Forum, but on the way to the Roman Forum. They will visit the Pantheon, the Colosseum, etc. And at this point, all I really want, unless you want more, is just the permission to pursue this further, check on the insurance, check on liability. And although I've been to Rome and twice, and Italy twice, of course, I want to be very careful about this trip. I want it to be no more than 7 students, and I think 5 would be the best number that I could have. I think you really want to know what SPQR stands for.
Well, I can tell you more. It's on the top of the Centurion Standard, so.
It's everywhere. Senatus populusque Romanus, the Roman Senate and people.
Questions?
Kathy?
If this doesn't require any time off from school, then I sort of am back to what Anne was saying. Does this require our approval at all?
I'm not sure that it does.
I think that will all come under the question we have about liability.
Yeah.
And so I think probably what we need to do is at least give him the approval to begin the process. And then as we look at the liability, we can determine whether a final approval needs to come from the board or not.
Okay.
My question on that would be an additional question. If Mort decides to take 5 students to Rome on vacation, does that in fact fall under the auspices of the school board, and would we have any liability? So I think that's another item to be checked into, but I'm not hearing, am I hearing from anyone that we're opposed to the trip? No, so Mort, the consensus is to move forward and, you know, pending all of this information that's come up on the liability question, as well it should, you can go ahead and make your plans.
I do have a question.
Oh. I'm sorry, Anne.
The limited number of students that you'd really like to take, is that based on the number of students in your course?
No.
Is that a logistical thing?
It's what I would consider a very workable number.
So how would you choose the students who would get to go?
The students, well, naturally, if a huge number of students came forward, then in fact I would get another chaperone. I'm just telling you at this point what the optimum number would be, the best number would be 5 to 7. If more came forward, then there is I'm sure I could find another chaperone. Maybe a parent would be interested.
Certainly, and the school board chair would be interested.
the other thing, fewer students take Latin at Cape Elizabeth than any other language because it's limited to two sections. This year we're offering one Latin 1 and one Latin 2, so there are fewer students to draw from. I don't think there would be more than 5.
Okay. I just wanted to be sure that as many students who were interested would be able to take advantage of the opportunity.
Yeah, the other opportunity would be perhaps next year. I really want this to go well, and I think that perhaps the fewer, if we lay the groundwork, then maybe next year there would be more.
Trish, did you have a question?
She asked my question. I was going to say how, if you have a limited number, yeah, you're going to be selected, so I'm all set. Thank you.
Thank you, Mort.
So just permission to explore at this point. Thank you, sir.
And we'll take care of that under new business formally. And David, are you just going to play a tape of your prior presentations?
Well, some of you weren't here for my prior presentation, so perhaps I should. Is that not true?
Yes. I'm not certain, but we always enjoy them, David.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Good evening. My name is David Peary. I'm a French teacher at Cape Elizabeth High School. I've come before you tonight to request your tentative approval to begin organizing an exchange trip to France. We've taken this trip twice before, and the city we are envisioning is Saint-Nazaire, which is located on the Atlantic coast at the mouth of the Loire River. Saint-Nazaire is a population roughly similar to Portland. It's a sea town. The Queen Mary II, which visited recently, was built in Saint-Nazaire. It has a great shipbuilding history, just as Portland does too. The high school we'll be visiting, we would hopefully be visiting, is a much larger high school than our own, as a more economically diverse population than ours. There are about 2,000 students in the high school itself, grades 10 through 12, and another 500 who are doing post-high school studies. This trip is more than eating baguette. It's more than walking down Champs-Élysées. It's more than sitting in a cafe. It's a great learning experience. Yes, there are great linguistic lessons that we learn in this trip, but there are great personal lessons that we learn also. Living with another family for 2 weeks whose language you don't speak brings out a great moral fiber in every participant who has to wake up on that first morning and go out and face these people that they might have corresponded with via email. It's an exercise in graciousness of becoming the best friend of the person that you're with for the next 2.5 weeks and that you will be hosting for 2.5 weeks when they come back. It's a lesson in generosity and putting forward your best foot and providing as best you can for this individual, even if they perhaps weren't as nice to you when you were visiting them. People grow tremendously over these 2.5 weeks. Parents have told me that, students have told me that. It's an invaluable lesson. It's not a part of our curriculum, but it's an opportunity that we can provide our students and to the person. Even people who've had negative experiences individually during that time have said, wow, I learned so much from that. It was such a wonderful experience for me. And I think the last time we were here, you heard from some of the students, and I think you heard from a school board member too at that time of how wonderful experience it was for them. So here we are. I have tentative prices, and I don't know if there's a fuel surcharge that's going up by the minute as we speak. I'm waiting for some final prices to come in. Promitour does offer an insurance package. I'm not sure how many, whether it's $1 or $10 million liability, but I can get that information for you and provide that for you so you can take a look at that. They also offer health insurance for the students while they're in France so that any medical expenses that have to be paid for can be taken care of. They also offer repatriation insurance that if a student needs to come home for an emergency, that we can get the student back to the U.S. in case of a family crisis or an illness. We would look to go in the month of February. That's generally been the plan. We would probably miss about 8 days of school, and then our counterparts would come back and visit us in the month of April, depending on where they're. It all revolves around vacations and vacation time. I did meet this summer with one of the chaperones of the trip. She was here visiting, and we had lunch one day, and she's all excited about the trip. There's another chaperone who coordinates this, and I've sent an email to him. They've just started school, so I think as the dust settles, he'll get back to me and let me know exactly what they can do and when they can do it. What I'm asking for you tonight is permission that I can start to contact students, get parents and students thinking about it, and give them timelines that we'll be looking at, and then come back to you, and obviously get you the information that you've requested from the other individuals tonight, and then come back to you in October and answer any other questions you might have. Obviously, if you had any questions in the meantime, I'd be more than happy to field them and send an answer back to everybody, rather than wait till October, so that when you make your decision in October, it's a well-thought, reflected decision.
Do you have any questions for David? David's been doing this for a while, and his trips have always been extraordinarily successful. Unless there are any questions, David, you have our consensus to move forward under the same restrictions as the other ones, answering the insurance questions, which is as much our problem as yours, and just the some sort of rider to your presentation that speaks to how students will make up work in other classes.
Surely. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, David. Well, with that, we can move on to comments from the public on non-agenda items. If we have anyone here who would like to speak, now is the time. I see no one taking advantage of that, so we will move on. Alan, would you like to, Alan and perhaps Elaine as well, move on to this recognition section?
Basically what this is Elaine had mentioned it a few days ago, and also we have gone through a process of recognizing our maintenance and custodial staff for the work that they have done this year. This afternoon, we had a luncheon for them to thank them for the work they have done as we've gone through a very trying time as we have worked on the renovation of the high school and had to, at many times during this summertime, pull staff members out from custodial maintenance to do some work based on cleaning, painting, and other things that were necessary. As Jeff mentioned this afternoon, I noted he said that in many cases they have been there, they have moved furniture to some place so that it could be in place, and then find out it had to be moved again, so they would move it again, and then we might have moved it a third time as well. But what we have found is that under Ernie's and Dave's guidance, they have done a yeoman's job as far as getting this done. Any of you who might have been in the high school 3 weeks before the opening, as I was practically every day, I know it was a very tenuous circumstance, but people kept telling me it would be ready, and it was. So I certainly want to recognize the maintenance and custodial staff for all the work that they have done. I also met with them today and began to talk about the issues around pride in the system and in buildings. I think it's very important when we each look at the schools and say they are my schools. They are very important to us. And so we talked about that, and one of the changes that we are going through at this point in time is that each of them will have a special shirt which they will wear, which says either Cape Elizabeth custodial staff or Cape Elizabeth maintenance staff. And also, as with everyone in the system today, they got their tags to recognize them as employees of Cape Elizabeth school system. So I think it's extremely important that we recognize the very hard work that they have done, the frustrations that they have gone through in this process as we've had to make changes and what you call changing courses in midstream, and it's worked really well. I don't know if you want to make a comment.
I would just like to say thank you for taking the time to recognize the maintenance staff with the luncheon today. And I'd also just like to add, in addition to the great work that they've done to get the schools ready, was that I like the people to know how much this maintenance staff has also saved us in the building renovation project. When we were breaking out some of the components and we knew we had to go to a contractor to have painting done, it was going to cost us X amount, the maintenance staff would be the first to step up and say, well, we can do that for less, and they would, you know, add that on to their work duty. So if I could ever have Pauline or somebody put a dollar amount to it so we could tell the taxpayers that they did that for us, I think it would be greatly appreciated. So I thank them for that also.
Thank you, Elaine. Anyone else? We'll move on now to the superintendent's report. Alan?
Okay. You had asked me to speak briefly about my first 2 months here, and so I will do that. Many people have asked me, what do you think of Cape Elizabeth, and how do you like it, and how does it compare with where you've been before? And I need to tell you that the last 2 months have been extremely exciting months for me. I've thoroughly enjoyed the work that I've been doing here. Certainly waited, perhaps impatiently, for students to get back and teachers to get back so I could see the real school system and how it works. But the 2 months before that offered me an opportunity to get to know an awful lot of people. For those of you who have never worked outside of Cape Elizabeth, as I have and as some of my administrators have, I need to tell you first and foremost, and I need to say this to board members, I have never seen a board that works any harder than the Cape Elizabeth School Board. I have had several meetings with individuals this summer. I've also had announced retreats this summer, which were extremely valuable, helped educate me about Cape Elizabeth, helped me to begin to take a look at issues that I need to deal with, some that are very in the forefront and some that we will be looking at as time goes on. But I can't compliment the board enough in the amount of work that they are willing to take on and do in order to ensure that this is a smooth-running, well-planned school system, and that the education that's happening here is meant to be the very finest that it can possibly be. I would compliment the leaders who are in the system. I have a DLT meeting once a month, which has been fairly historic, and I depend on these people. Number one, I depend on the history. Matter of fact, the first day, if some of you are with me, as I introduced people, one of the people I introduced was who I call Mrs. Cape Elizabeth, and that's the lady who's sitting down here at the end, who consistently gives me the history of what is going on here and is cannot possibly be spared at this point, even though she tries to tell me she could be, but it's very important. The DLT itself are people who have been here. Many of them have been here for a long time, have very clear understanding of what how things operate here in Cape Elizabeth, and I work with them very closely. A new wrinkle with this year for the principals is that I also meet with them individually. And I do that, when I say individually, as a group, because I find it very important that they and I have a lot of conversations, because to me they are the front line of your school system. They are the people who report to me. They are the people who keep those buildings running and keep them running as smooth as possible. And it's extremely important that we have communication back and forth, and that we also are constantly looking at the vision and mission statement of the system and working our way towards meeting those. And so I again compliment the DLT and the three principals. Steve, obviously, is a new principal this year, here, has been a principal in other places. So Steve and I are the new kids on the block, but I think we're learning very quickly and are finding it very exciting possibilities out there. And of course, we depend on Tom and Jeff, who have had some experience here over a period of time. I think Tom is 10 years now and Jeff is 6. And so they are very helpful in helping me understand where we're going. During the summer, I had many meetings with people from the community who would come in and call or might just stop by to talk. The newspaper people, I see one sitting in the background right there, who I've met with several times, have been very welcoming and have done a lot, I feel, in positive feedback through the newspapers for the school system, and I truly appreciate that. I sent an invitation out to staff early August. Many staff members came in and sat down and talked. We had conversations anywhere from 15 minutes to, I think, the longest one is 2.5 hours. But they were all helpful because they helped me understand where we are and where we're going and what our mission and vision is. So, and I've also met many people in the community who have been very helpful. Sue Weatherby has been extremely helpful in helping me understand the connections of the municipality or the municipal government and the school government. And it has been a new process for me, and I've really appreciated it. Now, I'm out in the schools, I'm visiting classrooms. I haven't had any teachers pass out yet when I walk in. They are pretty welcoming. I think there are some of them said to me the first day I visited the first grade classes, and they said they're a bit nervous, but that was okay. They didn't mind that I was there. I had a wonderful second day of school, I think it was. The first day the kindergartners were here, I had an opportunity to meet their parents in the halls and go out with them to the buses. Have been to the middle school for their first curriculum night. This week we have the high school's evening, and I know Pond Cove is also going to be having some evenings fairly soon. And I try to be out doing as many of those as possible. The one place I have not made it to yet, but I will be making it, is to athletic events. And it's just that it seems so every time there is one, I have another commitment that I have to meet. But I will be out to those in the long run. I'll get there. But in the final analysis, I would say to you that you have an excellent school system. You have some amazing, what I see anyway, is amazing facilities here. You have amazing cooperation between the town and the school department as far as maintaining buildings and programs, and I truly appreciate it. And I am thoroughly enjoying my time here. I enjoyed where I was before, but this has been a wonderful change. And as I've said over and over again, it's 2.3 miles from my front door. So I can get here very quickly in the morning.
Thank you, Alan. Are we going to do the energy consumption report now or under finance? I'm sorry.
What I would do is I'd like to comment it very briefly, and then I think Kathy will report on it. But you did find in your packet an email from Mike McGovern, which was responses to an energy price impact survey, which was done by the state. Mike sent this on to me. This reflects both the town side of the government, the municipal side of the government, and also the school department. As a result, we have begun to gather information about energy consumption, both the historical perspective of it, and also to begin to take a look at some figures down the road. And I think Kathy will speak about that when she does her financial report this evening.
Thank you, Alan. And on behalf of the entire board, I think I can speak freely for them that we're delighted to have you here and delighted to be working with you. We'll move on now to school reports. We will only be hearing from the high school tonight. We have changed our process, and you'll get more comfortable with that as we go along. But tonight it is a high school report on renovations and the accreditation schedule. Jeff?
Thank you. I think I will be relatively brief. The 15 members of the visiting team from the New England Association of Schools and Colleges are coming to visit the high school starting Sunday, October 16th. I think you've got all these dates in the past. They are leaving Wednesday, October 19th. We've had two opportunities in the last few weeks to meet with Kathy Spencer, who's the principal at Carver High School in Carver, Massachusetts, who is going to be the chair of our visiting team. Most of the 15 members, I think either 12 or 13 of them, are from high schools in Maine. Kathy happens to be one of the few who are from outside of Maine, and she's actually a commission board member as well, which will provide an interesting perspective on the process. But Kathy met shortly before school began with our steering committee for an extended time to sort of go over the details and the schedules of the visit, and she met briefly with the faculty last week, I think it must have been, just to get their feet on the ground, to introduce herself to them, and both of our opportunities to meet with Kathy have been positive. I just wanted to mention again, because I didn't go back to see what I had told the board before about the specific roles. I think I sort of said, I know there's going to be some Sunday roles, but since Kathy was here, I can give you some more specifics, but you may already have these exact times. The roles for the board are really Sunday, mostly it's on Sunday, and then there's an opportunity on Wednesday. But on Sunday, from 3 o'clock until 3:45, in the high school is when a group of the members of the visiting team will be meeting with board members who are able to attend. And that meeting will take place in room 314, which is Dr. Efron's room. It's a physics room in the high school. I'll certainly send this in an email to Alan so he can get it out to you as well. But it's basically a 45-minute meeting just for school board members. I'm sure Kathy Spencer will be there as the chair of the team, because I know she'll want to meet with folks from the board, and I'm sure there will be several other members. There is another two or three concurrent meetings happening during that same time, so it won't be the entire visiting team. From 5 o'clock until 5:45 in the cafeteria, I believe, high school cafeteria is a reception, and virtually our entire staff, a fair number of students and parents who will be meeting with members of the visiting team over the next couple of days will be invited to that reception as well. So that's 5 o'clock to 5:45. So those are the Sunday opportunities. And then really there is not another formal role for the board until Wednesday at 2:15. And that will likely be taking place in the high school library when the team will have wrapped up its business behind the scenes, and they will come to a faculty meeting, and Kathy will present a very brief sort of overview of findings. But it will be a very brief. It's on the order of 10 to 15 minutes. It's not by any means a detailed report on all the findings of the committee, but just hitting a few highlights. So again, that's Wednesday at 2:15 in the high school library, and I will email this information to Alan so he can distribute it. You can get it in written form. So that is really the accreditation. I thought I would just sort of mention that. I think you've gotten materials in the past about the accreditation visit. If you have questions afterwards, I'd certainly be glad to take those. In terms of the renovation, I have to take a moment just to add my appreciation to the maintenance crew and the custodial crew, which are two separate crews led by two entirely different folks, and they work different hours and that sort of thing. I want to particularly single out David Raymond, who's the head of the custodial crew. He has just done personally a phenomenal job in terms of the amount of work that he is personally doing, and then sort of gathering his staff to get together as a team, the staff from the middle school, the staff from Pond Cove, and doing what needs to be done. I mean, some of you, I think, were there at the high school in early August or mid-August and can appreciate, knowing what it looks like now, how far it's come. Now, it's obviously not all due to the custodial crew, the maintenance crew. The contractors worked very hard as well because they're aware of our time period. But David Raymond, I wasn't there, but he tells me there was one or two mornings that he was there at 2 o'clock in the morning, sort of waxing floors and doing all kinds of work, which was way above and beyond. But it has had a real payoff for our faculty and students. So much appreciation, and certainly to maintenance as well. I guess I also have to say thanks to parents. I won't thank the kids for this, because this was a pure benefit to them to have shortened days the first couple of days, but certainly thanks to parents to the extent they had to adjust their sort of teenage supervision planning activities for those first couple of days. We could not have had school full days those couple of days. We needed that time to continue to get ready. And the other thing I would specifically say in terms of appreciation to parents, it has to do with the traffic pattern. Parents have been great about pulling forward, as far forward as they could, I'm not sure what you call it, but it's a drop-off lane, essentially, in front of the high school. And I think that the traffic actually has been better than I hoped, than I feared that it might be. For the rest of the presentation, I'm going to address this by frequently asked questions. These are the top questions that I've gotten about the high school renovation project. And first has to do with traffic and how is the traffic working. And I think it's still something we're watching. Alan and I, we're both out today. We've both been out a number of times to try to see how things are going. And I can definitely say with 100% conviction that I feared that it would be significantly worse than it is. Most days in the morning, with the exception of today there was about for 3 or 4 minutes, there was a backup into 77 from people coming left into the high school from south on 77. I haven't seen that significantly, and that was my biggest worry. I'm sure that parents' perspective may be a little bit different, but certainly it's not a significant backup, and we feared that it might be. And in the afternoon, things have been going pretty well. The biggest struggle in the afternoon has to do with, for folks who want to turn right south 77, it would be nice, and we're exploring with the architect, whether that second lane can veer off a little bit earlier than it does for folks who want to turn south. But for the most part, it's been quite good. And I do also have to offer this perspective, that our student population is increased. We are almost 600 now, so it's increased by close to 30 students from last year, depending on what day you're counting. And we continue to have, I am confident, although I haven't done any study, a decreasing percentage of students who take the bus. So that whatever traffic pattern problems exist are not necessarily the result of renovation-related issues. They are tied up in some other trends that have been going on for a significant period of time. So that's my traffic report. The second most frequently asked question is, when will the front entrance be open? And I don't know the answer to that question. I can tell you what's holding it up is the rails that to go on the stairway leading up to the front entrance. The fire chief and the town building inspector have quite appropriately said to us, for safety reasons, we cannot open the front of the building until there are railings. Those railings have been ordered. They are somewhere in the process. I don't know physically where, but I believe they're being polished somewhere. And one of these days that will show up in front of the high school, and then we will open up the main entrance.
Feedback we got today was October 3rd.
October 3rd, okay. A definite date, that's great. I've also had questions about when will the Achievement Center be open. And we had made a plan, a deliberate decision, which I think I've reported to the board, not to actually open the Achievement Center for kids until sometime in October. We've been a little bit vague, deliberately vague about exactly when it was going to be. And the reason for that was we've been talking to folks who have writing centers, who operate writing centers or Plato centers or learning centers in other high schools. And the one consistent message we get from all of them is make sure before you open, that the regular faculty, the regular teachers know what the services are that will be offered, will sell the services of the Achievement Center to their students, and will be on board. And so we are spending some time behind the scenes doing that. So we really didn't plan to open until October. We had hoped to have the staff in the Achievement Center by this time, and there is a holdup right now that's related to a delay in getting the carpet in that area. So we're doing some work to get them temporarily, I hope, in there by sometime next week, but we won't have the carpet until a few weeks after that. What's going on with the phones? This has been the biggest surprise of the project so far, I have to say. For me, it's consumed an awful lot of time, and for Pauline as well, I know. We are working with the phone company. They are working with us to try to figure out what's going on, but it's something to do with a voicemail system, which we may have to spend some money to upgrade. There are some other problems that were going on as well that had to do with wire pulling and that sort of stuff, particularly in offices that are down in the least complete industrial technology arts wing. The phones there have been particularly problematic. Andrew from ECS, who's been the tech, who's spent a lot of hours, was there today. I'm not sure if Ernie's maintenance department got phones back yet, but I see Alan shaking his head. So hopefully we are making some progress. The voicemail system is being very funky right now, and there's some odd times when it works and times that it doesn't work, and it works some ways and not others. So we put out on the website for parents to let them know that we're having problems with our voicemail, and we continue to have them. It's better than it was a week or 2 weeks ago, but there are still significant problems. When will the new soccer field be used, be usable? Best guess right now, probably spring 2007. We'd hoped fall 2006, and it's probably spring 2007 because we ended up having to delay the planting considerably because of the very, very, very wet spring, this spring. When will the work in the arts technology wing be done? Not sure, I think within a month. Some of it will be done earlier than within a month, but the whole wing, I think, I'm hoping will be done about a week, 4 to 6 weeks, essentially, which is still way ahead of February 2006, which is when it was originally projected to be done. So we're in good shape. What remains to be done, work on the ceramics room remains to be done. It will begin after the large drawing and painting room in the industrial arts technology wing is done. Then we will bring the art teacher back to his regular space and start renovating the ceramics room. The library work, which we hope will get done sometime around, a little bit after, but sort of within the Christmas vacation. And auditorium work, we're actually going to talk about that, I think, in some detail this Thursday to figure out when that is going to be done. My hope is it will start by mid-October and be done by sometime in January, but that's a hope right now. How are we doing overall in the project? We're ahead of schedule. Perhaps we're under budget, but I'm not going to say that with any great degree of confidence, but I know we're ahead of schedule. And when will we have doors in the main office and guidance? I'd like to take a pool. I would have lost several weeks ago in the pool. I'm not sure. We're waiting on hardware which is compatible with the doors. It's not a big deal. We're in business, but we would certainly like to have doors on the main office and guidance. And that is my report. Frequently asked questions. I don't know if there are any questions about either accreditation or the renovation.
Ann?
I had a question.
Yes.
When the Achievement Center does open and after the staff is fully trained and students are, you know, informed about using it, because it's such a new and unique to us endeavor, are you planning on sending something out to parents so that parents can understand what's going to be available to their kids?
Absolutely. We haven't determined exactly what form it is. My guess is it will be a letter accompanied by a brochure.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments? And I would just add that, as you know, Jeff, there is a high interest in the new center, so we'll be looking forward to hearing somewhat regularly, if not formally, on how things are going and what issues have come up and what challenges and how we're addressing them. We certainly all want to make this center work.
Ginger Raspiller, who's going to be the new coordinator of the Achievement Center, and I were talking last week about once it gets ready to go, among the other things we would like to do to sort of publicize it is probably to have a couple of evenings when parents can come in, and probably one special evening for folks from the Education Foundation and from the board as well, so that you can sort of get a very up-close view of what we have in mind for the Achievement Center.
Terrific. Thank you, Jeff. Okay. If there's nothing else.
Thank you.
We'll move on. Committee reports. You'll notice that the list of committee reports is rather extensive as compared to how it was in the past. This was a decision of the board at our retreat to allow individuals who are working on various committees on behalf and behest of the board to report on exactly what they're doing and what's going on a more regular basis. So we will begin with our standing committees and Finance Committee. Kathy, please.
The Finance Committee met briefly before this committee this evening and also has another meeting scheduled for 1 o'clock on Thursday because it gives us a little more time. Anyway, When we met, we signed warrants and reviewed appropriations reports. We also had a financial update on staff changes from Pauline, and also a report from her on MMA, workers' comp, and property tax, property insurance refund. I think the majority of our time we spent discussing the energy cost, and Pauline put together a report for us. We're just starting this process, but she's put together a report for us indicating what we're using currently for heating oil, electrical, gas, what we've done in the past, what we're projecting with the current pricing in place. And I'm sure it's no surprise to anybody that this needs to be reviewed and looked at. So there's some indication that we're going to be looking at this at least on a monthly basis, probably more frequently, and keep updating this as it will severely impact our budget for the year. And again, we're just sort of at a starting point, but just to let people know that we're going to be on top of this and communicating what we know and going forward, how dollar-wise it's impacting in the different areas, total and probably by school. And I think that was pretty much it, unless anybody wants to add. Most of the people were at that meeting.
Thank you, Kathy. Any questions for Kathy? Moving forward, Policy Committee, Ann.
Policy Committee met one time over the summer. We met July 19th. We reviewed a number of policies that had been presented in June for first reading that people had some questions or needed some clarifications around. We discussed policy ICAI, which is religion in the schools. We discussed policy IJOB, athletic trips, and followed up on some suggestions from the June meeting. Went over various typos and that kind of thing. We discussed or just clarified the process for the homework policy, which we have been working on for a while. As some of you might remember who are watching in June, that hasn't been presented yet for first reading. We've done a draft of that, and the three principals will be giving that to their staffs if they haven't had a chance to do that already, and getting some input and feedback from them, and then bring that feedback back to our next policy meeting. The remaining I policies we will be taking up with policy IKD, which is the honor roll. We still have maybe a quarter of the I policies left, I being the instruction section. We won't be doing that in September because we do have some sections that we need to wrap up that some of our other administrators have been helping us take a look at over the past year, and those are the technology policies. Gary Lanois will be attending our September meeting. The fiscal management policies, Paulina Portria will be helping us with that. There's some new procedures and guidelines for distributing medications that have come down that we need to take a look at. And we will also be talking a little bit more about religion in the schools. I had so that we would be presenting that tonight for second reading, but there has been some feedback and some questions about that, which we as a committee need to talk about. Our committee schedule is going to be changing this year. In the past, we've met the first Tuesday of each month, but this year we're changing it to the third Tuesday from 12 to 1:30 or 2 here in the conference room. That's because our workshop schedule is changing. And I believe that's it.
Thank you, Ann.
Rebecca has a question. Kevin, I have a question. Will we be talking about how the policy committee plans on addressing the nutrition policies that are going to be required to be in place by next fall?
Yeah, we will be talking about that.
And that will be at the next meeting?
I don't know. You know, we can put that on our September schedule and see if we can get to that. You know, actually, but there is one issue around that, isn't there, Alan?
Yes.
That we need to address, not the whole thing, but there is a specific issue around that we need to talk about.
Sale,
yeah, right, that's right.
Fundraising.
Yeah,
So we will be talking about that piece then. I mean, I don't know if we're going to be able to fit all that in, but we'll try.
Okay. We have a subcommittee report under this Substance Abuse Policy Review Subcommittee. Trish?
The subcommittee, which was formed last spring to review the athletic substance abuse policy, has a meeting scheduled for Tuesday, September 27th at 8 o'clock. We met as a refresher just last spring to get organized to review this policy. So at this point, in October, we'll have some information or an update on that meeting.
I think I might have said athletic abuse policy, and this is really just a substance abuse policy.
It encompasses actually two policies, drug and alcohol use by students, which is policy JICH, and athletic substance abuse policy, which is JJJ-R1.
Right. The next communication committee, Rebecca?
Right. We are struggling to come up with our first meeting. We actually have lost two school representatives, Kelly Hassett and Kathy Walsh. Kelly obviously has left the school district. Kathy is going to be a team leader, so I'm waiting to hear from Steve as to who will replace Kathy for the middle school. And then based on that, we're going to try picking another day that will work for everybody. But we are obviously very excited that the board approved the goals and strategies last June, and I think our focus this year will be on implementing those goals and strategies.
Thank you, Rebecca. On to personnel, Elaine.
As most of us know, the Personnel Committee is pretty much a newly established standing committee. Last year, it was established but spent so much time on the superintendent search that this is the year when we're going to hopefully do what the Communications Committee did, which is to establish some goals and procedures and exactly what does the Personnel Committee do as part of the school board. I've done some internet searching of some other districts, and I think we have some stuff to work with. But based on the retreat priorities, I believe that this year we're going to be looking at the hiring procedures and the teacher supervision and evaluation books that were done by the board 3 or 4 years ago. We do need to establish a superintendent evaluation for this year. We'll be looking at all the job descriptions and making sure that they're updated. And then, of course, we'll be entering into negotiations with two groups this year. The first being the administrators, and that will be Kathy and myself, and we'll be contacting them by the end of this month so we can get started on following up on that. And then we will be negotiating our teachers, and both Kathy and Ann Belden will be negotiating with the teachers this year. Before I just close with personnel, as far as I can tell, I am the only person on the Personnel Committee. And I think we need to, at some point, designate a few helpers.
Actually, in all the confusion last year, I'm still on the Personnel Committee. I just dropped the chair position in favor of you, so I'm still around.
Okay, so I just couldn't find a printout anywhere that said anyone, if it's an agreement. I'll just work with Kevin then and Alan and get that started.
Elaine, I thought, but I'm not sure, that I was on the Personnel Committee, at least at one point. When am I? Was I?
There was a lot of confusion, so why don't why don't we toss it out for everybody to express
anybody
their interest?
We have this
in
sheet.
In the committee. And
the sheet of paper that we have, it's just not listed as a committee. So I'm happy with whatever, you know, we decide upon, but I'm just throwing it out to the board so that they're aware. If you want to have a different process or have Mary check into it based on some past records.
Yeah, I thought that you were too, Kathy. That's
sort of
my reflection,
you know.
Yeah, I think
maybe my name just didn't show up on the list.
I do believe it was originally myself, Elaine, and Kathy.
Yeah.
And we got bogged down in the personnel in the superintendent search, and because of, well, for personal reasons, I stepped down from the chairing.
Well, and I think that the Personnel Committee just did a yeoman's job with the whole superintendent search, and maybe we should retire now.
Not a bad idea.
And principal search, too.
Yes, that's right. That's right. Principal search.
Okay. We're going to move on. Oh, yes. How can I forget the Planning Committee? Elaine?
Just very briefly, Alan and I are starting to meet. I met once with Tom before he left, and I met again with Bob Lyman. And we did have a five-year plan. It needs to be updated. We've asked the DLT for some input. We've been gathering some information from the Education Foundation, who has some lists of some things and working with the DLT also. But we need to pull this together and decide in what manner we're going to put this information out and what are the priorities of the school system over the next 5 years, not only from a financial point, but also as far as tying in with future directions. That committee consists of Henry and Tricia, and we have a meeting tentatively scheduled for September 26th at 1 o'clock in Allen's office. But I will follow up with the other participants to make sure that that still works.
And certainly anyone who's interested, any other board members interested in attending that meeting are certainly welcome to do so. Move on to appointed committees. There may be a few things out of place here or missing, but we'll proceed and get through it. The first is the Athletic Steering Committee. Elaine?
Yeah, we met in June. I don't think I reported on this because this was after our board meeting. But just so that you're aware, that this committee does meet a minimum of 2 times per year. It consists of some community members, a school board member, representatives from the high school and middle school, Keith and Sue Weatherby, Keith, of course, and Scott Labby from the middle school athletic position. And we generally review any new sports applications and the budgets, but this past June we really took a look at the Sports Done Right, because that had come out from the state and the board had asked for us to take a look at our athletics and to initiate some sort of public forums or discussions around that. They came up at this time with a nice timeline and some ideas on what we'd like to do in the community. And as of with that timeline, this fall, starting in September, we hope to be meeting with some coaches to present Sports Done Right. And this would involve not only some of the school coaches, but we would be making this available to travel teams and community service coaches, outside groups. And we initially talked about a November public forum, which would be led by a committee panel and some speakers from the state as featured speakers. So we'll need to meet and get that rolling outside of the other two meetings that we normally have during the year. So I know there's a lot of people who are interested in this, and we'll get back to the whole board if they want to attend as observers with the dates.
Terrific. Any questions for Elaine? We'll move on then to our legislative liaison, Rebecca.
All right. Last year, I think I tried sending out a legislative summary via email, and then realized quickly that I was duplicating what was already coming from Maine School Management Association. So I stopped doing that. I think I did write one board position in response to legislation. What I would like to ask other board members is, if you see any legislation that you feel strongly about, that the board would like to, that you think the board should take a position, if you would just email me and summarize what you feel the appropriate position would be, and I could try to come up with some sort of statement, and then I would share it with the board for approval. And in addition to that, if you think that there's anything else that the legislative liaison can do for the board, please let me know. I know at one point we talked about going up and testifying, but I know last year that we had Staff doing quite a bit of that, and I certainly think he was an excellent spokesman for our district rather than myself. So I would probably encourage the actual staff and administrators to do the testifying, but I could perhaps facilitate that for any issue that you feel that we would need to have a presence be in Augusta for.
Any questions? The next is the Maine School Board Association delegate, which is not a committee per se. It's a position I occupied last year. I could not attend. Elaine took my place and was barred from the meeting because we didn't do the paperwork.
It didn't look like you said.
And in any event, the primary role of the MSBA Association delegate is to bring back the board's vote or consensus on resolutions that have been circulated by that organization for adoption by the entire organization. That's the primary function. The secondary function is to receive information during the course of the year and disseminate it, such as the resolutions, which has happened automatically. I do not plan to continue in that position for personal reasons, and we will be looking for a delegate later in the meeting. That's it for the time being on that. An appointed committee that is not listed is the PASS General Advisory Committee. Alan will be joining us. Two members, a member of the school board and the superintendent of the school board, are voting delegates to the General Advisory Committee of Portland Arts and Technical High School, which serves the needs of many students that don't fit into the typical education program. I have chaired that for the General Advisory Committee at PASS for many years. I continue to chair the General Advisory Committee, and Alan and I will be attending a meeting shortly. Our primary function as delegates will be in budgeting issues and curriculum issues. Are there any other committees under appointed committees we might have missed?
I think the Education Foundation.
Okay, yes. Elaine, that actually does belong under under appointed committees. Do you have anything for us on the Education Foundation?
Yeah, I just want to just remind people that in June, they closed out their grant activity with a round of grants that totaled $92,000 for our schools, $50,000 of which went to the Achievement Center, and $25,000 was approved by them for the high school laptop expansion, and then the bulk of the rest of it being the teacher grants throughout the three school systems. They have currently another grant cycle for this fall, which is geared towards professional development applications from the schools, and so that is going out to the teachers currently. They've been quite busy over the summer laying the groundwork for their three-year capital campaign, where they're looking to raise $750,000 in our community. Most of that money will be earmarked for the achievement centers and for classroom and professional development grants, and then 20% of it will be going towards an endowment to provide the perpetual source of funding for the future. I think that all of the school board perhaps today or tomorrow may have received in their mail an invitation for September 29th. CEEF will be holding it's a social event at the Sherman's House on Shore Road, and there'll be members of the community, past members of the Education Foundation, town council, school board members, and they'll be doing an update on their fundraising and what they are doing in the school. So it's a great opportunity for us to see them in action. So I would encourage everyone to try to make it on the 29th if they can.
We'll move on then. under board advisory committees, we have the athletic advisory committee, which we're all a tad baffled about. So is, I think Elaine has included most of the information in her initial report.
So does that committee not exist?
I don't believe that committee exists.
As I said, we were just listing committees. And our final listed committee, and it may not be all of our committees, is the Comprehensive Plan Committee, which again is Elaine.
They met through the summer. We're looking at some of the other towns' questionnaires and some of the methodology on gathering community input and data on what the community sees Cape Elizabeth to look like over the next 10 years. And after all was said and done, we decided that we would entertain two presentations, which we saw a couple weeks ago, from Market Decisions and Critical Insights. And they will be, I don't think we've made an official notification of who we have chosen to provide the service, but they presented two very different opportunities that range from phone calling of a critical amount of families in Cape Elizabeth or homes in Cape Elizabeth with a 15 to 20 minute survey to physical surveys that would be mailed out to the taxpayers. So what we end up with will be based on the recommendation of the firm for which we decide on. But that will be, I think, probably sometime this late fall, early winter. But we are meeting once a month, and we are anticipating another 18 months. So we'll look to give school board input when that opportunity comes.
Thank you, Elaine. Are there any other committee reports that might have been missed, or does anyone have anything they're working on that they would like to inform the public about? All right, then we will move on to unfinished business, and our unfinished business is consideration of policies for second reading. I believe the first reading was at our June business meeting, Ann?
Right.
So there's been considerable amount of time spent on these policies, and I will turn this over to Ann to present them, and we'll move forward.
Okay, even though the I policies are the first ones here on the agenda, I think I'll just do the B's first because those are a lot shorter and there aren't too many issues related to those. So what you have before you are pretty much, actually, I don't think there were any changes made from the first reading.
Just one word somewhere. Mm-hmm. You had one word change somewhere.
Okay. So would we like to, we can vote on these all as go by one by one. We can do them in a group or we can go one by one.
I'd like to suggest we do them as a group unless there's any objections. And seeing no objections, I'd like to move that we adopt these policies as recommended by the policy committee and thank them for their work on this. I get to do that now under the new policy. Is there a second? Trish? Is there any conversation or comment on these policies? Seeing none.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm slow.
You had emailed me a question.
I do. I have it right here.
Rebecca, on
I'm trying to connect
BDE that. Board
BDE
standing
under A.
Yeah.
Page what? That would be page 5. Could the second sentence read, the committee shall be provided with a list of its specific functions and duties as approved by the board.
Sure. sounds good to me.
Does that constitute a significant change?
No, I don't think so.
Sorry, I'm not there yet.
Consider it. Okay, let's go.
Is there any objection to that? Are there any other comments or discussion on this matter? I thank the policy for their work on this. All in favor? Opposed? Adopted 7-0.
Okay, so for the I policies, there are a lot of policies here. And because of the time constraints at the June meeting, we didn't go through and list them all, but we did ask Mary to put them on the website, the names of each of the policies, which she did. So for the public, you know, anybody who you know, was interested, I'm sure that they accessed that and could see. So what I was kind of thinking is, because Rebecca, you also had some questions on some of these, I think it gets a little complicated to vote on them in a group and then go back to them. So I don't know, I was just sort of thinking of trying to quickly go through them one by one, so that, and I'll just name the name, and then if anybody has any, and I'll, we can move on them that way. Does that make sense?
Aside from the questions that Rebecca has relative to specific policies, and then does anyone else have questions or concerns with specific policies?
I just had one on IHOA, that specific, the field trips, specifying the month that we needed to receive the a notification on. That's the only question I have.
Okay, so with that information, I turn it back to Ann to handle this as however she feels is appropriate.
Okay, so I mean, if we can just quickly go down them, if we don't have any questions, we don't even have to comment on them. Okay, Alan, I have a question. Do I need to formally table ICAA religion in the schools, or?
I think you do. We've had a first reading, you'd have to ask for tabling.
Okay, so I'd like to make a motion that we table policy ICAA religion in the schools and pending discussion at our upcoming policy meeting next week.
Do we have a second? Thank you, Rebecca. Any comment or question? All in favor? Policy is tabled for further work.
Okay, I'd like to move that we approve policy ICB, extended school year services.
A second. Thank you, Elaine. Conversation?
Just so I can understand, what was the reasoning for changing the one sentence?
Yeah, you know, taking out that one sentence in the second paragraph? Is that what your question pertains to? You know, I don't remember what the attorneys were, what they were suggesting in regards to that, but I just remember that we took their suggestions.
It appears that Claire has some information on that.
All of the language changes that were recommended by our attorney has to do with the new changes in both the federal and state regulations. So what he did is he reviewed our special ed policies and his role was to bring them up to date with the language that's now being reflected in our regs.
Thanks, Claire.
Anything else on that? All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. I'm sorry, it's 6-0 tonight.
All right, policy ID, scheduling for instruction, time on task. I'd like to move that we accept this policy as presented here.
Second. Trish, thank you. Conversation? All in favor? 6-0.
Okay, and we don't have to actually vote on ID-R because it's a guideline. Yeah, sure. Okay. Policy IGA, curriculum development and adoption. I would like to move that we accept this policy as presented here.
A second. Thank you, Elaine. Conversation, questions?
Yeah.
Rebecca?
Yeah. I'd like to know what was the reasoning for changing this policy away from what is recommended by the Maine School Management Association.
Well, there was a lot of discussion around this policy, actually, and
I'm sorry I wasn't there to hear it, so if you could
just... Well, that's okay. I'm not, you know, just noting that we did have discussion. And that item, you're talking about mainly F? Is that the main one that you're talking about?
Well, yeah. I mean, the whole policy is actually different. Mm-hmm. So I'd just like to know why.
I can't really summarize the whole discussion because, honestly, I can't remember it. So if any of the administrators who were there have any better recollection than I, what I was going to comment on was I do remember the conversation mostly around F, which is where most of our time was spent. And that one, as what we're presenting tonight, so people know that currently what we're proposing that read is the school board shall approve the course of studies in each January for the following year pending budget approval. That is a little bit changed from our current policy. People want me to read that?
Yes.
Which, for that same item F, which is the school board shall review and adopt all curriculum guides, course descriptions, and courses of study prior to their implementation. And so I remember that the discussion that we had around there, you know, Trish, you were there, so if you remember, was we really felt that didn't accurately reflect practice, current practice, and that it wasn't really reasonable to think that would in the future reflect current practice. And so we actually reworded that several times and had discussed a lot, and this is what we felt was probably the most reasonable or, you know, most realistic portrayal of what was and should be happening in the school system. Do you have anything to add to that, Trish?
No, that's...
Yeah.
Are there any other questions?
Well, I'm actually would like to engage in a conversation about this because I understand in practice the school board hasn't been doing this, so my question would be, is the right approach to change the policy to address what the practice has been, or to change the practice to address what the policy should be as stated by the Maine School Management Association? I have looked at their policy, and I actually looked around at other districts through the Southern Maine community, and actually beyond, and most towns follow exactly word to word what the Maine School Management Association policy is. Therefore, I believe that they believe it is an important role of the school board. And I would ask the other members, do we as a school board think that is what our role is? And I know we briefly touched on it, Alan, in your office, and you seem to think that there was a role for school board participation in curriculum discussion. So I have to say that at this point in time, I am absolutely not comfortable voting in favor for this policy as it is written.
Okay, well, I guess...
I think the vote will...
Can I just ask, I'm not sure I'm understanding what your objection is. You're objecting to the school board participating in the decision of the curriculum, or?
No, not at all. It's actually the opposite. If you look at what the Maine School Management Association wording is, this is a substantial weakening of the role participation of the school board.
Okay, I see what you're saying.
I mean, just for people who don't have this policy in front of them, there is item E, which reads, it is expected that curriculum development and revision be achieved with appropriate involvement of administration, instructional and support staff, students, community, and board. So, I mean, it does, I know what you're saying, and that it's an interesting discussion, and that's, you know, is the, perhaps not in that kind of detail, but the discussion that we had to some extent. So there, I just want people to know out there that there is a role outlined in this policy for the board. So the board, we're not proposing a policy that relinquishes, you know, complete involvement at all.
For clarification, what you read as to what was in our previous policy is the Maine School Board, their policy.
I believe so. Yes.
I'd like to point out that the policies supplied to us by the Maine School Management Association are suggestions/recommendations which are in some cases, in my experience, adopted without much thought by some school boards, and in cases like ours, pored over rather thoroughly by our policy committee. And while I understand what Rebecca is saying, the fact that they have adopted policy in other school districts does not mean that that is the practice of the actual district. I'd certainly be interested in that, but in the interim, I think that this is a good starting point. There is no policy on this board that is carved in stone. If an adjustment needs to be made, we will accommodate conversation on the adjustment. And I also think that the whole curriculum issue is really a much bigger conversation that needs to be looked at. I believe we identified curriculum as one of our priorities, and we really haven't had the opportunity for a full discussion of that.
Yeah, I mean, I understand and appreciate the work that the policy committee did on this. I have attended some of the meetings, and I know how extensive the conversations are. Unfortunately, it's impossible for all board members to be at those meetings, and therefore it limits the capacity for this board as a whole to have a conversation around this issue. And for me, this is a substantial issue for the goals of what a board does in Cape Elizabeth. I have a question as to if somebody were to come forward with a problem with the curriculum based on this language, who would be dealing with it?
Okay, so are you asking the policy committee to take this back and
I don't really
take
know,
another look at it?
I think the board needs to talk about this. And maybe we need to have a separate conversation, or we have it tonight. But for me personally, I needed to say this evening that I'm not ready to approve this because I don't feel as if we as a board have had a conversation at length that this would deserve.
So I guess what we need to do at this point is take a vote unless other people, and if it gets turned down, then it'll go back to the policy committee.
Are there any other immediate concerns about the policy involved in question? Because I'd like to move the vote if there isn't.
Are you looking to move the vote to vote on this policy as it is? We don't have the option to table it at this time.
We certainly, well, we can do that after we vote on whether or not.
You can propose to table it if you want.
There's a motion on the table, though.
There is a motion on the table to adopt the policy, which was to facilitate conversation.
Sure.
And I think we need to proceed to that, and if it fails, this can go back to policy. And adoption of this policy, I don't think precludes further full board conversation on the topic of curriculum. It is one of our priorities, and I believe ultimately it should be one of our workshops. There is a high interest, I believe, of every member of the board in working on policy, not policy, but curriculum.
And perhaps that discussions could sort of evolve around how will the board be involved in the curriculum development with the other groups that are mentioned here.
If I could just add a point, is that as we talked about before, and I think at our retreat, it is the charge of the board to oversee curriculum. One of the major charges that come through state law. I think the other piece that, though, we all need to realize is curriculum development and adoption is changing very rapidly because of the main learning results and the LAS. And so there are also policies that we need to look at. And I remember when we had that last meeting, was that in August? The discussion was there are some sample policies out there around the LAS and MLR, which we've got to take a look at. And you have those samples, as do I. So what I see this at this point in time is an overriding policy that just kind of gives the language for this point in time. but there will be other things added. I think, Rebecca, if I'm understanding your question correctly, and correct me if I'm wrong, I think what I'm hearing you say is there is nothing in here that allows for the questioning of curriculum, and how, if there is a question about the curriculum, how do we go about it? Is that part of what you're looking for?
Yes, among many other things. Yeah. I mean, I think what I'm really saying is that we as a board have not really talked about this policy at, and any sort of the implications that it may or may not have. But I just think that before we approve this, we have a chance to kind of come together and agree that this does actually address what we see the roles as being and would address any sort of situations that would arise. And I'm willing to do that this evening or at another time.
And if I could just add one more thing, and I think if you look at the cross-reference, there's also a cross-reference policy that also goes with this, which is evaluation of instructional programs. So we need to take a look at those. You know, again, you can take a vote to see if it is voted up or down, or if the person who made the original motion wants to rescind that so it could be tabled, you could also do that.
And once I'd just like to add, regardless of that particular decision, that does not preclude full discussion of curriculum at a workshop or in any other arena that we so choose.
I guess before, as a person who made the motion, before I think whether I would want to table it or not, I guess I'd like to have some sense from other board members if, I mean, there's really, you know, if nobody else is feels like they need to have more discussion and input, and I do want to say that the full board can't discuss every policy in detail, and that's the job of the policy committee. Not that the full board can't, you know, raise questions, which is what you're doing, but I guess, I mean, are other people feeling like, given Rebecca's thoughts, that they would like to have more opportunity? I mean, to do that?
I think the simplest way to do this is to ask once more if there's any further comment on the policy, take the vote. And
well, that's what I was trying to do. I'm trying to get a feel for if people are, just ask the question. I mean, if that's, so I guess what I'm hearing is people really.
Lane?
And I'd like to just say that I would appreciate having another opportunity to just take a look at it. I originally was in support of it, but Rebecca's brought up some points. I just want to reread the original and the cross-reference outside of this meeting tonight and come back and vote on it again.
Okay, well then, since there are two people who are interested in talking more about it, I'm willing to...
Can I just, sorry, interrupt you. I wasn't aware that that was a change because you know how sometimes we have the cross-outs and so forth, so I wasn't aware it was a change. And I don't necessarily agree or disagree, but I haven't really had time to sort of think about all of it, so I would, you know, I would mm-hmm. I would like to support somebody who has concerns that it be discussed mm-hmm. further before we say this. I mean, I understand what Kevin's saying. Yeah. We can change it, but.
And that is a good point, Kathy. I'm not sure why it's typed like, I think somehow we just dropped the ball on changing, having the crossouts and the red ink and all that stuff. So in light of all those thoughts, I would be willing to table my motion. Does that require a vote? Oh, rescind my motion? All right, I'm rescinding my motion.
And would you now move to table it?
And I now move.
I'll second to rescind.
Okay, second to rescind.
All in favor? 6-0.
And I'd like to make a motion that we table whatever that policy is,
IDA
for consideration next month.
I'll second that.
Anyone else? All in favor? 6-0.
Okay. Okay. Policy IGBAA, referral, pre-referral. I'd like to move that we accept this policy as presented.
Second.
Who's doing the second? Kathy, for the record. Conversation? In favor? Opposed? 6-0.
Okay, the next items you have here are guidelines. We don't need to vote on those.
Next policy is IHB, Cape Elizabeth School Policy on Reading Instruction. And I would like to move that we delete this policy.
Second. Elaine, conversation.
Why are we deleting this policy?
As I remember, and I don't know, Alan or Claire, maybe you have, but I think that this was, oh no, it wouldn't be Claire, sorry. I think it was because this is really no longer relevant with the main learning results, that there are other policies that are directing that. That is my recollection. Trish, do you remember anything else?
I wasn't in on the conversation at the time, but it does say at the top, this policy does not currently reflect programs that it doesn't. And so what this would be included in the MLR, yep. LAS policy that you still need to put together.
Are there any other questions? Seeing none, all in favor? Opposed, 6-0.
IHB Individual Education Plans. I'd like to move that we accept this policy as presented.
Second. Rebecca, conversation. All in favor? Opposed, 6-0.
IHBAB Student Educational Records Policy. I'd like to move that we delete this.
Second. Trish, thank you. Conversation?
Do we have the JRA policy already in place?
I think that they provided us with that.
So we have
we'll
sample.
Be getting
we're
to
not
that.
Okay.
Yeah, that's in the J section.
Thank you.
Any other questions? All those in favor? Opposed? 6-0.
Okay, the next item is a guideline. I'll address that. Okay, now we're on page 31.
Whoa.
So we're at IHBAC, Child Find Policy. I'd like to move that we accept this as presented.
Second. Rebecca, conversation. All those in favor?
Just for clarification's sake, these that you're accepting as presented, we will, though, put a revised date as of 9/15/05, just so that it shows it was reviewed. Okay.
Yes.
IHBAD, Model Procedure on Personnel Development. I'd like to move that we delete this.
Second. Trish, thank you. All in favor? Opposed? 6-0.
IHBAE, I'd like to move that we delete this policy.
Second. Trish? Conversation?
Yep, I've got a question. I believe that NCLB requires all districts to have a parent involvement policy. I'm not sure it's supposed to be under IHBAE or KBF. I was just wondering what the plan is.
Well, this is a special education policy, and so what my thinking is that this is probably superseded by other special ed guidelines. And
I think what happened, it was superseded by another one, and this was just never deleted at the time.
Right. Do we know what that other one is?
I'd have to look it up.
I don't have the policy manual at this
point. Okay. And do we have a KBF policy? Does anybody know? Because
I don't have my policy.
My policy manual is.
What is KBF, Rebecca?
I think it's another parent involvement policy.
And is that a special ed one also?
I don't know because I don't.
Treats it.
Okay, so have you read? I mean, is it? What do you know? What the content of it is? The KBF.
I've just seen it listed in my manual. I actually don't mm-hmm. have a policy. Mm-hmm.
Rebecca, just as a point of information, the fact that a policy is listed in the manual doesn't mean it either exists or was ever adopted or considered by us. Those are forms that are provided to us, and we just kind of...
Yeah, the listing that's in the front of each section of the policy manual, what that is, it's a listing of policies that, you know, can exist, that are, you know, that are available, that they have
samples on, but we don't necessarily have those. And actually, we've had the conversation about how this new policy manual will be organized. It won't have that listing because I think that is confusing.
Yeah, all right, thank you.
Clara, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think most of these special ed policies moved to the K area as opposed to the I area a couple of years ago, if I'm not mistaken. This is what I remember from the work I was doing in another system, but we can check that tomorrow and see what it is.
What language did Aaron have on top of that policy?
What it says, we recommend that the board delete this policy from the manual. There was once belief that a policy in this area was required, but whether that was once true or not is no longer so.
And I think that's accurate. I understand that at this point we no longer need that policy. And I think another thing we need to be clear of is the policies that you're voting on tonight that deal with special education are based on the language in our current regulations, which will be changing.
Okay. So we have more policies to look forward to. Okay, so we need a vote.
Is there any other question or conversation on this? All those in favor? 6-0.
IHBAG, policy on programming in the least restrictive environment. I'd like to move that we accept this policy as presented.
Do we have a second, or Elaine? Any conversation or questions?
Does this belong in the K section too?
That's what I've got to check. We've got to take a look at that and see. But if this was the way it came from Eric, then I would guess that this does stay at the IHBAG.
All those in favor? 6-0.
The next item is a guideline. We'll skip over that. So we're on page 37, IHBAI, independent educational evaluations. I'd like to move that we accept this policy as presented.
Do we have a second? Elaine, thank you. Questions, comments?
Just have a quick question. The attorneys are indicating that it's not a required policy, is that right?
So it says at the top, yeah.
Well, it is not.
They said, well, it's not required, it's a good policy to have.
Do we bind ourselves up in any way by having it? You know, like if we don't need it, should we not have it? I guess, and I'm sure you've asked that question. I just am asking.
We actually have a lot of policies that we don't have. The list of required policies is surprisingly small given the thickness of our policy manual. If we wanted to make it really easy, we could delete all. There are just so many that are not required.
Can I just ask, Claire, is this something that you think is beneficial?
Definitely. I would recommend that we have it because it's a nice, whenever we have a request from a parent for an independent evaluation, it's nice to be able to say, here's our school board policy, and it's in line with the state regulation, so it's clear and helps explain it, I think, in an easier language than the regulations.
Okay, thank you.
If I might point out, the recommendation is, again, while it is not required, we think it is good policy to have. And when our attorneys suggest to me that it's a good policy to have, then it's a good policy to have. Are there any more questions or concerns on this? Seeing none, all in favor? 6-0.
IHBB. Gifted and talented. I'd like to move that we accept the policy as it is presented here.
Second. Thank you, Rebecca. Conversation? All in favor? 6-0.
IHBEA, limited English proficient students. I'd like to move that we delete this policy.
Can I have a second? Trish, thank you. Conversation? Seeing none, all in favor? 6-0.
IHBEA, limited English proficient student notice. I'd like to move that we accept this policy.
Second. Elaine? Conversation? All in favor? Thank you. 6-0.
Next item is a guideline. We'll skip over that. Which brings us to page 47, IHBG Home Instruction Program. I'd like to move that we accept this policy.
Second. Trish. Conversation.
Question. All right. Page 52, under 12, letter B. Bear with me while I find it.
Maybe. You know, Rebecca, I think, are you referring, I think it's on page 58.
58,
the question that you have.
Yeah, you're right. That's why I can't find it.
Well, are we even on that policy?
No, we're not. I'm sorry.
Are we on IHBG?
Wait.
Yeah, your question's on IHBGA.
It's the new one. It's the new one I have a question on. Sorry. Okay. We're deleting only right now, right?
Yeah.
No.
G is one to accept.
Are we on home instruction?
Oh, yeah, IHBG. Yeah. That's IHBGA, Rebecca.
Okay. We're talking about file HBG, Home Instruction Program, yeah. Page 47.
Sorry, got it.
Okay. No, any other questions? All in favor? 6-0.
Okay, so IHBGA. Homeschooling participation in school programs. I move that we delete this policy.
Do we have a second? I'll do it. Conversation. Rebecca?
No, it's for the
next
one.
Oh, okay. All in favor? 6-0.
Okay, so this is the new IHBGA, which they're recommending we replace the old one with, which begins on page 53. Again, it's homeschooling participation in school programs. I move that we accept this policy as presented.
Second. Lane. Conversation.
Before Rebecca asks her question, could you give just a highlight, I hope, of just what the changes are, where it's, you know, so there's so many pages. Do you know, I mean,
you know,
the big issues? Or is it just a little
I really blurred? Don't. I'd have to go back through here. It's so long ago that we even went through this. Honestly, I don't. I couldn't. I'm sorry.
Never. I withdraw my question. That's all right.
Rebecca, did you have something?
Well.
I'm counting down.
I know. I'm sorry. No, okay. I'm not going to ask this question. I'm all set.
All in favor? 6-0.
IHCDA post-secondary enrollment options. I move that we accept this policy as presented here.
Second. Trish, thanks. Conversation. All those in favor? 6-0.
IHOA field trips and excursions, non-athletic. I move that we accept this policy as presented.
Second. Lane. Conversation.
The second to last paragraph says any other field trips, but yet that's the under the excursions. Should that would just be changed to excursions? Second to last paragraph. Any other field trips?
Yeah, sure.
So we're differentiating, right, between a field trip and an excursion?
Yeah. The other comment that I have, which is what I was thinking about when we had those field trips presented earlier tonight, is the first paragraph under excursions, which reads, the school board will receive annual notification in September of out-of-state and overnight excursions, which are regularly scheduled as part of the established curriculum. So I guess that was one of the things that was confusing me in the discussion, you know, earlier tonight.
And I also had raised the question as to whether or not, on that same note, do we need to specify September? And I understand that we obviously, that whole area is sort of gray.
And I think Elaine, I'm sorry, go ahead, Elaine.
And I can remember that at some point when we were having a lot of discussions about outdoor experience and the philosophy behind it in the community, that November typically was the month that Nancy would come before the board with the programs that were involved in that, because that involved an overnight, it involved fundraising, it involved, you know, just some decisions on the part of the school board, because it was a curriculum item. Mm. So that's kind of the historical perspective for that paragraph. But I guess the question comes in, you know, if it's not part of the curriculum, like the French trip,
why are we hearing
it? Why are we looking at it? It doesn't really fall under this policy. And again, also, you want to take into account some of the field trips we'll hear from the high school in the spring, usually from someone like Ted Jordan to go to Washington, D.C., or to the Stock Exchange. Those are part of the curriculum, I think. And we don't want to bind their hands by saying September's the only time. We want to be able to see them before. So I think you need to have a few dates if you're going to have any dates at all.
As Elaine mentioned, which has brought back my memory on this, back a long time ago, the outdoor experience thing was very tenuous. It was being challenged every year. And I believe that the policy was adopted so that particular thing would have to come up every September for conversation, because there was a, at the time, the board was rather split on whether or not that was a valuable experience and part of the curriculum. At this point in time, it occurs to me that the outdoor experience is, in fact, part of the curriculum. Whether or not we need to have any reference at all to September, it perhaps might serve our purposes better to require, we will be advised 30, 60, 90, or whatever appropriate period is before the event happens. I offer that as a substitute for requiring September.
But what about the whole other piece of it, which is the established curriculum? I mean, I see that as a really big issue here. And I'm not sure. I'm thinking I'm going to rescind this motion. We can talk about
this. I was going to also say, if you continue and read the last paragraph, it says, staff, students, and parents may plan and engage in such activities on their own, understanding that the board and the school district accept no responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so unclear what responsibility we have that I was going to suggest that we, I know we have to take a vote, but I would suggest we take it back and investigate these and become much clearer.
Because that ties right into my comments earlier, right, with those field trips. So instead of taking a vote, I'm going to rescind my motion.
Before Ann rescinds, I just want to go back to the point I made with Mort's request that since it didn't involve school time, the question of whether or not we had any responsibility for it whatsoever. So yeah, I agree with the conversation on that. So do I have a second to rescind the motion? Do I need to do that?
Who did you second it?
Elaine seconded.
Okay.
Right, the original motion was made by Ann, so before she rescinded, I'll second the rescind.
All in favor of rescinding? Robert's Rules of Orders.
Okay, I just want to say, I don't know when our committee meeting for next week is, you know, getting pretty lengthy. So, I mean, we'll put these, we have a lot of items on our agenda, but these, hopefully in September, October, we'll get to these.
Might I suggest that we not require a specific return date when we do this kind of stuff? Leave that to policy.
IHOAA, year-end activities. I move that we accept this policy.
Second. I'll do it. All those in favor?
What's the point of this policy? I'm sorry, I just don't understand what
you know, I do remember the discussion around this one, and it was because apparently in the past there were some issues around beach trips at the end of the school year, and whether or not the school should be taking them, and so at that the board at that time, that board felt that a policy was needed on it
to authorize us to do those types of things.
To give the administrator sort of the go-ahead so that we didn't have to, so that, or they didn't have to keep having the discussion about whether, you know.
Okay, thanks.
Any further questions? All those in favor? 6-0.
IHOB athletic trips. I move that we delete this policy.
Do we have a second? Trish, thank you. Conversation? Seeing none, all in favor? 6-0.
Okay, there was a policy that was IJOB was missing from your packet.
You should have all found it.
Yeah, okay. So it was on your, it was missing in your packet, but it was put on your.
Okay, because I was curious as to what it read.
Because it was missing, it was just an oversight. It wasn't put in there. But we're not there yet. Okay. IIB class size, I move that we accept this policy as presented.
Second. Trish, thank you. Conversation? Seeing none, all in favor? Opposed?
IJJ, selection of educational materials. I move that we accept this policy.
Second. Trish, conversation? All in favor? 6-0.
Okay, so now we need to delete the current IJJ. I move that we delete this IJJ.
I'll second that. Conversation? All those in favor? Opposed? 6-0.
Which brings us to IJOB athletic policy, athletic trips. And I move that we accept this policy.
Second. Trish.
Can you tell me what the, again, what the variance is between what we had and what we're adopting? Is it just the red sentence?
Yeah, that came out of the last month's board meeting. That discussion, the red sentence.
Okay.
There also is a section in the old one, subsection C, referring to tryouts and participation independent of an extraordinary trip, that is not incorporated in this new version. And so I was wondering why that was omitted.
Oh, wait, what? Okay, now I have the old. What are you looking at, Rebecca?
Okay, the old IHOB, which we do have in our packet, has a subsection C, and it says, tryouts and participation in athletics is independent of an extraordinary trip.
That's IHOB.
This is
IJOB.
Yes.
But they're both athletic.
But they're both about athletic trips, so I'm assuming we're kind of replacing IHOB with IJOB.
In fact, that's what it says at the top of IHOB.
Okay. So my question is, why are we not including that subsection C?
I don't know. One of the things we were trying to do is that there's so many athletic policies, so many little athletic policies all over the place. One of the recommendations from Drummond Woodsum was to try and streamline them somewhat so we didn't have them all over our policy manual. And I think that that's where that came from. But I hear what you're saying is that you want to know why there's a piece in IHOB, which is being deleted because the entire policy is, and you'd like to know if we could incorporate it into IJOB.
Yeah. I actually thought it was being replaced by IJOB, so if that's not the case, then could we possibly include then this subsection?
You're right. IHOB is being replaced by IJOB.
Okay, or superseded, whichever.
Right.
I think, though, it is covered. C reads, tryouts and participation in athletics is independent of an extraordinary trip. The fourth paragraph under athletic trips, if the team has not been officially selected, the trip must be made available to all students interested in being a member of that team. So that is actually more inclusive for IJOB is more inclusive than IHOB, and that sort of says the same thing, but in slightly different terminology.
I
actually read it differently.
Is there language needed to clarify? I'm not thinking.
I'm not really even clear with that. What does that mean to you, Section C?
Yeah,
what are you reading? What are you interpreting from that?
I'm now reading IJOB just to see if that is. Okay. I read it as saying, I thought it meant that if somebody could not go on the trip, they could still try out and participate in the flags.
And that's still the case. This doesn't exclude it. This just says if the team has not been officially selected, the trip must be made available to all students. So even if you don't go on the trip, you can still participate. You're not excluded from that. This says even if you're not on the team, if it hasn't been officially, if they're still in the tryout stage and you're interested in going, you can go. So it actually
really more inclusive.
Yeah, it incorporates and gives the opportunity to more students than the old.
Is there any time when a student finds out that they actually cannot participate in a trip, that it would impact they're participating in the team?
I believe that's what this policy tries to address.
Right.
I interpret it the way Trish did, and I believe I participated in some of the conversations around this athletics, and that was specifically the purpose, was to make this more inclusive than the prior policy was.
I
support it.
I support the inclusiveness of the statement in IJOB. I just am interpreting C as being a little bit different. Whereas IJOB is saying you can go, as long as the team hasn't been officially selected, people can participate in it. That's great. My question is, if somebody is interested in trying out for a team but knows that they cannot participate in that trip, can that impact whether they can be a part of that team?
By policy, no.
Which policy?
Not this one. This is athletic trips only, so it wouldn't deal with participation. So this one should be focused only on participation on a trip, not the whole tryout and participation.
So bear with me. Have we seen the athletic participation policy yet? Do we know where it is, where it lies?
Is there one? I don't. Well, that's part of the problem, is that there's so many different policies that speak to athletics, which is one of the reasons why we're trying to, you know. So I'm okay with the way that this is. So could we just
I think we need to move this to a vote. All those in favor? Opposed? 5-1.
IJOC, volunteers. I move that we accept this policy as presented.
Second, by me. Conversation? All those in favor? Rebecca?
I'm sorry, you guys are whipping through this. I don't even know where we are.
I'm sorry?
Well, we just were on page
78. Yeah, 78,
yep. All in favor? 6-0.
Okay, Alan, this policy needs to be moved to section K. I think that we're gonna deal with it then. So does that require a vote or anything?
So you just wanna hold off until you get to that?
Yeah, we have not reviewed this because we just said we're gonna move it to section K.
Okay, yep.
And that is it. Okay, well, thanks everybody. I know that was a laborious process, but it represented several months of work and a lot of independent work as well from the administrators and the policy committee, and so I really appreciate everybody bearing with us and taking the time to read the policies and all of that, so thank you.
Ben got to it before me. I would just add a ditto to that. Okay. I'm missing a page of my agenda. All right, we'll move on to new business. Consideration of the superintendent's recommendation for athletic fee participation for fall 2005. Ellen?
You have a document here. The first page is from Scott Labby, who is the athletic director at the middle school. You have several new coaching nominations, and you also have returning coaches. Do you want me to read these individually, or
I'm certainly happy with moving them as a group. I don't see any objections, so Elaine?
I would say that we need to go by the names so that the community knows who we hired.
I have no problem with that either.
It won't take but a minute.
Okay. You are, so should I read them as a whole or read them individually and vote on each one individually?
Can we just read them all and then vote on them all
yeah,
together?
Okay.
That's how we've done it in the past.
Okay.
Just read them and vote.
So for the new coaching nominations is Michael Schwartz, eighth grade girls soccer, 124.8 hours at level three is the pay level. The second one is Paul Casey, girls middle school cross country, 100.8 hours at level two. Diane Nicholson, seventh grade field hockey, 124.8 hours at a level two. Matthew Reed, middle school tennis assistant, 90 hours at a level two. And William Steinroeder, middle school tennis at 120 hours at a level three. Also on this, for your information, those are the nominations. Returning coaches are Joe Doan, boys middle school cross country, Terry Long, eighth grade boys soccer, Jim Dolliner, seventh grade boys soccer, Patty Franson, eighth grade field hockey, and Molly Thompson, seventh grade soccer. So the new coaching positions that you are looking at are the first five, Michael Schwartz, Paul Casey, Diane Nicholson, Matthew Reed, and William Steinroeder.
We have a motion. Elaine?
I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendations for the middle school coaching positions.
Thank you. Second. Trish? Conversation? All those in favor? Opposed? 6-0.
I have a second page on this, which is an email from Mark Tinkham. This is here is information on Monica Bergman as the freshman girls soccer coach, and what he does is give a brief overview of her past experiences.
Motion. Elaine?
I move we accept the superintendent's recommendation to hire Monica Bergman as freshman girls soccer coach.
Second. Trish? Conversation? All in favor? Thank you.
And I have a third one, which is from Keith Weatherby. New coaching recommendation. This is Darcy Holland, freshman field hockey at the high school.
A motion, please.
I move that we approve the superintendent's recommendation for the hiring of Darcy Holland for the freshman field hockey.
Thank you. Second. Elaine? Conversation? All in favor?
And that's all the athletic ones I have.
All right, we now have recommendations for co-curricular fee positions.
You also have a packet on those. The first one is from Claire Labrie. Consider nominating Karen Johnson and Kim Hanlon as co-coordinators for Special Olympics. She mentions here that they would share the 125 hours and the stipend of $1,437.
I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendation for these positions. Second. Trish, thank you. Conversation. All in favor? Opposed, 6-0.
Second one is from Jeff Speed. The stipend notice, in addition to the CAT department chair, one I sent you recently, and I'll read that in just a minute. 10th grade class advisors Hannah Jones and Carrie Aponovich. 11th grade class advisors Carrie Curtis, is that how you pronounce it?
Curtis.
Curtis and Courtney Farrell, and 12th grade class advisor Gretchen McNulty.
Motion, please. Elaine.
I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendations for the class advisors.
Thank you. Second?
Second.
Well, thank you, Ann. All those in favor?
And the next page is also from Jeff Shedd. I think the first one, which is 10th grade class advisor, you just voted on. The second one is English department chair Hannah Jones and Gerald Schroeder. And the CAT members are Sharon Merrill, Ernie LaPointe, Katie Lisa, and Ben Raymond. He said he has also liked to have Belinda Snell appointed as the chair of CAT. And he notes that when they started CAT, she was the chair with a double stipend. I have chaired the committee for the past couple of years, so there was no stipend. There is a budget for this amount, and Belinda would get the stipend she normally would have as a regular CAT member, plus a stipend that in the past has gone to the school nurse. And those are the pieces to that.
Do I have a motion?
I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendations for the class advisor stipend position.
Do we have a second? Elaine, thank you. Conversation? Go ahead.
I just had a question as to why one particular person would get the stipend of another person if they're not participating.
It really has to do with the history of the CAT. When we originally created it, Belinda in the first year was the chair, and she did get a stipend that amounted to a double stipend. I took it over for the last couple of years, so I didn't get a stipend for that. But it's continues to be a stipend that's in there as a separate leader of the CAT stipend, so I'm really recommending. I was trying to give some historical background. I may have confused a little bit, but there is still on the books a separate stipend for the leader position because it involves preparing the agendas, putting together the minutes, and doing a lot of organizational, and obviously chairing the meetings themselves. So.
Okay, so they're receiving a stipend for their role as an advisor and then an additional amount for leading the advisor team.
Yeah, you could look at it. Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah, sorry.
I just want a clarification. Yeah. Thank you.
Anyone else? All those in favor? Opposed? 5-1.
And the last one I have for you is from Cape Elizabeth High School Art Club proposal. This is submitted by Mary Hart, who is the Cape Elizabeth High School art instructor. But she has recommended that Sarah Collins, a jeweler from Portland, be hired as the art club advisor for the fall and spring programs during the academic year 2005-2006. She goes on to talk about Sarah's qualifications and the work she has already done with the students at Cape Elizabeth High School.
Motion. Trish?
I move that we accept the superintendent's nomination for as Mary Hart as the art instructor for the art club, for director of the art club.
We're not voting not Mary Hart, though.
No.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Sarah.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm reading Mary Hart as late. Yeah. Excuse me. I will amend my original motion to I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendation to hire Sarah Collins as the art club advisor.
Second, Rebecca. Conversation, all in favor? 6-0.
And that concludes those.
Okay. Let's move on to update and approval of summer hiring, Alan.
Okay. What I've presented to you is a listing of the resignations and hiring that have been done during the summer. Based on the approval that you gave me in July in order to carry on. What I have before you is a resignation is Kelly Hassan, who is a teacher leader at Pond Cove. I have a 1-year leave of absence for Holly Smedog, who is a 0.5 technology integrator at Cape Elizabeth Middle School. New hires as teachers are Sarah Welch, a 0.5 grade 8 social studies teacher at Cape Elizabeth Middle School. Nicole Ball, who is a half-time kindergarten teacher at Pond Cove and will also be a half-time special ed tech 2. And I have Dean Zaharis. Dean has been hired as the halftime technology integrator at Cape Elizabeth Middle School for 1 year to replace Holly, and has also been hired as a halftime EdTech 2 at Cape Elizabeth High School, and will also share some of those duties with Cape Elizabeth Middle School. We have educational technicians, our Megan Dubois, special ed in EdTech 1, 2, excuse me, Elizabeth Gogan?
Gogan.
Gogan. Special education, EdTech 2, and Paula Schrank, special education, EdTech 2. Betsy Goldstein, EdTech 1, Pond Cove. Our computer technician is Matthew Young, who comes to us from Great Britain. Part-time bus driver, Nathan Maxwell, and part-time bus driver and custodian, Doug Prevost.
I would move that we affirm superintendent's hiring as well as his acceptance of resignations that occurred during the summer hiring period.
Second.
Thank you, Ann. Questions, comments? All in favor?
I do have a question. Marla Bono part of the summer hiring, or?
Marla has just been hired on a short time basis, so that will need to be added next time. Interim basis for 30 days.
Any other questions? All those in favor? 6-0, thank you. We move on to consideration of the approval of a technology lease, and I just know Kathy is not going to read the entirety of this lease.
No, I'm not. I'd like to move that we authorize the superintendent to execute and deliver a tax-exempt lease purchase agreement with Gorham Leasing Group in the name and on behalf of the town of Cape Elizabeth. And the amount is $52,604.
Thank you, Kathy. A second, please. Rebecca? Conversation, questions? All those in favor? 6-0. Thank you. Technology lease approval to receive and spend all federal and state grants for the 2005 and 06 school year. Can I have a motion to that effect?
Thank you. So moved.
Second. Thank you, Elaine. Conversation. All those in favor? Opposed? 6-0. We will move on to consideration of a request for proposed exchange trips. I would like to consolidate all three of these. They are F, G, and H, as they've already received the consensus of the board. To simplify things, I move that we allow the individual instructors to proceed with plans for trips to France, Costa Rica, and Italy as presented to us tonight. Second?
Second.
Lane? No, Lane or Ann. Conversation? All those in favor? 6-0. Okay. We move on to public comment. Oh, yes, I forgot. Yes. Appointments quickly. We need a delegate, or we don't necessarily need a delegate, but it would be nice to have a delegate to the Maine School Board Association Delegate Assembly, which is October 27th, I think.
I think that's right.
I would warn everybody in advance, the job is to affirm the resolutions. You get to wear a nice tag. But if you're going, it means that you will miss an entire workshop period. So please take that into consideration. Do we have anyone who is interested in the position?
Just so you know, the days that these fall on, we have no school.
I know. It's always
been every year.
Really?
Year. Yeah.
This is my first year of experiencing that.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've been.
It's conferences, so that you miss.
Yeah.
I mean, the opportunity to do your conferences, but you, they accommodate you in other ways. There's usually other ways.
Okay.
So, I don't see anybody who's interested. So for general purposes and principles, I will appoint myself knowing that I won't be there so that I can, I'll send a note that we favor the resolutions or something along those lines. And the only other purpose will be for me to receive communications during the course of the year to be dispersed to everyone else. So if we could have a motion. Thank you, Elaine.
I nominate Kevin Sweeney to be our delegate.
Okay, second. Thank you, Trish. All those in favor, any conversation? All those in favor? Opposed. We have another opportunity. There is the beginnings of a high school forum. Elaine and I originally were participating in that. So Elaine's appointment, so far as I'm concerned, is grandfathered under prior policy, and she will continue as one of the school board reps to the high school forum. I'd certainly love to do that. That's where my heart is, but I am no longer available on Wednesday evenings forever. So that position came open. I think there's been multiple expressions of interest, the primary, of course, being Ann. And based on some feedback I got, some very good feedback I got, I think what I would like to propose is that we leave this an at-large appointment so individual school board members can circulate through and experience what's going on with this high school forum. Again, that's based on feedback from other members. That's not an original thought on my part. So I would like to move that the position be filled as an at-large and that Ann will begin this first organizational meeting and then we will board itself and make its own plans on how to circulate through. If that works, can I have a motion to accept that?
So moved.
Thank you. Second? Thank you, Trish. Any further conversation? I'd just like to say that I'm really excited about what's going on with the high school forum, and though I can't participate directly, Jeff, this has my personal support, and I will do anything I can on the side to help make this successful. All right, that leaves us off with appointments.
You didn't vote on the motion.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, thank you. It's already a long night. All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you. What's next, Alan?
Public comment.
Public comment, okay. That's actually on the agenda. My apologies, my eyes are hurt. There is no public comment. We'll move forward. School board agenda requests. Anyone? Although it's not a matter of formal policy, as we move forward planning agendas, everyone will receive an email at an appropriate period of time before the agenda meeting takes place so that there's another opportunity for suggestion and input in that entire process. Upcoming meetings. Alan, I'm going to defer to you on this, please.
Okay. What we have listed for dates to remember is Finance Committee meeting on Thursday, September 15th, 2005 at 1 o'clock in the Superintendent's office. Policy Committee meeting Tuesday, September 20th at 12 noon in the Jordan Conference Room. School Board Workshop, and a reminder that we've changed School Board Workshops to the first Tuesday of the month so that they can be televised. And our first one will be on Tuesday, October 4th at 7 o'clock in Council Chambers. And the focus of that will be evaluation and a brief report on MEA results. School Board Business Meeting, next School Board Business Meeting is Tuesday, October 11th, 7 o'clock in the Council Chambers.
Thank you, Alan. The last item we have on the agenda is consideration of the superintendent's request to enter executive session to discuss a personnel issue as provided by, and I'm not going to read the legal reference because I'm not, and it's on the agenda, and the agenda has been published to the public. So if anyone has a question on the legal citation, please consult Alan. Do I have a motion? Thank you, Trish. Do I have a second? Thank you, Rebecca. All those in favor? And I forgot to do something earlier today. I have this special gavel from a special